I finally got myself a metal lathe thanks to Vivor for providing me with this 7x16 mini metal lathe. Vivor sells all kinds of interesting tools and machines on their website. In fact, you can also find a lot of their stuff on Amazon, but you might as well head straight to their website instead of letting Amazon take a cut. What made me realize I should finally get a metal lathe is when I made these thread adapter bushings to go in this load cell to this threaded rod. But I made these just with a drill press and a tap and die set, and I didn't always get all the holes perfectly centered. So the shaft isn't always straight on here, and these load cells are very sensitive to off-center load. So this wasn't ideal. I initially plopped it down on this table over here, but that was not an ideal working height, just too low. So I put some blocks of wood under it to get it to a more comfortable height, and that wasn't so hard to do because this lathe isn't that heavy. I could just pick it up. I then turned those blocks into more of a stand and brought the lathe over to my main workbench for while I'm using it. What's interesting about this lathe is it's actually direct drive, and the motor is actually right in here, basically around the shaft here. So if I pass something through the spindle here, that's actually passing it right through the middle of the motor. But this motor doesn't have very steady speed control at really low speeds that I need for cutting threads. So I figured hand cranking it would work better. So to that end, I made this crank. And the way this locks in place is I just tighten this screw down here, and that jams it in there real good. And now I can go as slow as I want, and I still have perfect control. And the big dowel for this crank, I made that on the metal lathe.
Got the gear set up for the right thread pitch that I need. Now, in the manual under material compatibility, it says wood, plastics, and soft metal like brass, copper, aluminum. I'm using steel because it's cheap and strong, so this is pushing the lathe a little bit. Now, for cutting threads, after every pass, I actually have to wind it backwards to move the carriage back so that I can be sure that the carriage is going to be in just the right position for doing the next depth cut. And checking against the thread in the load cell. It goes in there, but it's too tight. So I'm going to take a few more passes off of that thread. Now this coupler nut is long enough for two thread adapters, so I'm just flipping it over and I'm going to cut another thread on the outside on the other end. Now this one's actually going to be an M12 thread, so I had the brilliant idea of actually turning my nut down to 12 millimeters. Before I cut the threads, that'll cut down a lot on the hand cranking. Now, I was getting quite a lot of chatter while I was doing this. This is partially my lack of experience, but starting with a hex nut also doesn't help in terms of chatter. So I'd been doing all this machining with the wooden crank actually still stuck in there, but it works surprisingly well with it in there, even at higher speeds. And now separating the two parts with my motorized parting tool, because I don't have a proper parting tool yet.
And that worked out really nicely, and previously I made thread adapters for my other load cells. This is a 1.5 ton load cell, and this is my 500 kilogram load cell. Another part I want to make with the metal lathe is to replace a crudely made but important bushing on this screw jack on my joint strength testing machine. On this machine, the motor turns this gear, which turns this nut, and that screws this fixed threaded rod up and down. And to cut down on friction with this nut and the base, I put this ball bearing in here as a thrust bearing, but it's a 15 millimeter bearing and that's a half inch threaded rod, so I had to make a bushing to keep that centered. And that is a rather crude-looking bushing that I made because I didn't have any machine tools. So I decided to mill a better bushing using this bearing sleeve on my metal lathe.
But I am not an experienced machinist.
Gah! I guess milling a bushing out of this brittle material wasn't a good idea. It seems to be cast iron even though it's red, but it gets picked up by a magnet.
But I realized instead of relying on this bushing to keep the threaded rod in the center here, why don't I just use a bigger nut here, a coupler nut, and then I can mill part of this to fit in here, and that'll keep it centered nicely. And I got quite the unavoidable chatter and vibration while cutting away the hex part of this nut, but it is, after all, a mini lathe that isn't really meant to cut in steel. I ended up going a wee bit smaller than the bearing, but that's okay. So these pluses indicate the rate of increase in force, and that used to always have a much more noticeable wobble to it than it does now, so I think that new bushing really helped keep things more on center. And I don't think this sample will let go before we reach maximum force, so this is just a dummy test. Presently 400 kilograms, that's 200 kilograms of side thrust on that ball bearing. 500. So at those high forces, sometimes this skips a little bit. And we went to 600 kilograms, at which point it gave up, said too much force. But we don't see the wobble, we just see random variation on here, so that's a big improvement. So it's been fun making stuff with this lathe, but it has needed a little bit of work. For example, the pinion that engages the rack down here when I turn this crank used to hardly engage, and it made a lot of rattling sounds, and so I ended up shimming this part here a little bit to tilt it in to bring that pinion on there a little bit better. Also, the machine ways, when I first took this apart and put it back together and tightened these screws down here, it jammed. It turns out the bottom side of these machine ways was only machined very roughly and not super accurately. So I've been going over it with a dial indicator like this and moving that along, and using a metal file, just rubbing it along like this to fix the high spots and also smooth that. So now it's on there much tighter and there's no play on this part anymore, which makes it work much better. And I've had the carriage assembly all apart. This tool post holder, I actually sanded a slight concave into it because before that it was slightly convex and so it had a little bit of wiggle room that way. And these cranks here, they indicate in thou, and there's 40 thou per turn, so you'd think it'd be 25 turns per inch, but actually they turn in millimeters, but actually even that slightly less than a millimeter. So these thou scales are useful for, you know, figuring out how much you're going to take off in terms of depth of cut, but not useful for absolute. Minor defect there. This angle scale, I've seen this on a lot of mini lathes and videos, is actually kind of useless because when you loosen the screws in this thing here, which you can only get at by cranking this all the way back. Now I can loosen these screws in here, and that allows me to change the angle for the tapering thing here. But even if there was a pointer on here, it'd be kind of useless because it has a fair bit of, because it has a fair bit of slack this way. So putting a pointer on here wouldn't help very much. And this guard needs to come down before you can turn it on. But how far this comes down is only determined by these two set screws on here, which are in fairly thin metal. And so that slips, so the first time I turn it on, this actually hit the chuck. So I added this little block of wood to keep it from coming down too far. It just hits on there. And for threading, you have to put different gears on here to get the right gear ratio from the spindle down to a lead screw here to cut the right pitch of thread. And there's a table here that says which gears you need for which thread pitch. But for the 1 millimeter thread, this refers to an 84 tooth gear, and it doesn't come with an 84 tooth gear. So I decided to just work out what gear ratios I can use, so I made a spreadsheet for that, and I entered all these values into my spreadsheet just to verify, and it turns out a lot of these ones are actually inaccurate, the values on the table here, so don't go by that table. I just used my spreadsheet to work out what gear ratios would work for what I needed. And by inaccurate, I mean not just a little bit off. So if it's within 1.1%, I'm kind of okay with that, but two of these are quite a bit off,
And then for the imperial threads, none of them is even within 3%, so kind of useless. Which is not to say it can't cut imperial threads, it just means you have to work out the gear combinations yourself. So it's definitely a hobby-grade machine, and you should expect to spend some time going over the machine, tuning it up to work perfectly for you. And in terms of results you get, I've been able to get better results than I got earlier in the video, because how well it works is not just a function of how good the machine is, but also operator skill. And I'm working on that.
No, that's a pretty satisfactory surface finish.
But I'm not a machinist, and I'm not planning on becoming one, because doing metal stuff, everything just takes forever, and you get so dirty and greasy, I really have to be careful not to touch any wood, because then it's stained forever.
But even without machine tools, I've been able to make the metal parts I needed just fine, mostly with an angle grinder and a drill press. Like these parts here, or the metal bits for a blade guide on here, or even something like this conical point on the tailstock of my homemade lathe. That was actually cut with an angle grinder. And I wasn't the first one to put a hand crank on the headstock of a metal lathe for threading, but the ones I've seen online were all made by machinists because they have a metal lathe, and they're much more elaborate and all that than this one, whereas I'm a woodworker and I banged this thing together in less than half an hour.
But I guess that's the difference between machinists and woodworkers.
But I'll be using this thing for woodworking too, for things like making large diameter dowels, or things like these hose adapters here. This one, and especially this one, could have been made much more precisely if I had a metal lathe. So this lathe will probably be in a few more videos to come, and as much as I wish this lathe was a heavier, more solid lathe, I do appreciate that it's easy to move. Now, with all this playing around with machining, I'm very tempted to buy this cross-slide table to use with my drill press, and this is on Amazon, $209 Canadian, and then I looked on Vivor's website, same one, same six pictures, $169, free shipping. Then going back to Amazon and checking the reviews, with a bit of work, it's a win, value's there, but a bit of sweat equity, so yeah, probably same kind of quality as the lathe, but I can deal with that.
So Vivor's not for everything, and I'm not totally endorsing it, but if you're shopping around for something like a machine and checking various websites, Vivor's one of those websites that's worth checking too.